Hello, Biblionauts. I am at the gates of the Galloway Forest now. I'm about to find out if there is such a thing as a forest, or if I am, after all, correct in my claiming inveterately that there is no forest in the UK. But yeah, I guess I'll let you know. I'll let you know if I do find anything that doesn't feel like a woodland. Yeah, I was in the train and I took a couple of books with me for this trip. Books that I didn't mind getting rid of after reading. And one of them, the one that I wanted to get rid of the most, was this one, which I offered to send to any of you in this channel a while ago, and no one wanted it. So I decided to reread and for the last time in the train, and I thought it would be a good opportunity for me to talk about the book a little bit. It's this time the reading has been very different from the last time, because probably because I'm doing the read along from the Dialectic of Enlightenment, that suddenly so many things in here felt so connected to what Adorno and Horkheimer wrote in the Dialectic of Enlightenment. There is, of course, all the general themes of any dystopia, because this is a dystopia. I always forget to sort of like give you an introduction. I kind of assume already that you've read it, which probably you have, but maybe I should say this is a dystopia. This is a dystopia that like influenced Orwell. Huxley says that in Brave New World, he says that he did not read it. And the awful introduction by Margaret Atwood that this edition has, the first thing that she says is, I didn't read it before. Which is like, okay, fair enough. The fact that you have to say that on the very first paragraph, and not only do you have to say that on the very first paragraph, but that you even have to underline it, that you even have to give it like extra... how do you call it? Like, it's all in blacks, so it's even more on your face. I didn't read Zamyatin's remarkable novel We until the 1990s, and she wrote her novel, I think, in the 85. So it only makes me mistrust her, and it feels like she only wrote this introduction in order to be able to tell people that she did not read this book before writing her novel. I don't know if it's true. I don't have strong opinions about Margaret Atwood, but I found that like so unnecessary. It's not required. And if you are gonna say it, why start with that? I don't know. I don't know. It's maybe it's me ranting at without a reason, but it just felt completely out of place. But the book itself, honestly, the first time I read it, I didn't like it so much. I had read sort of like the other three big dystopias, including Fahrenheit 451, which for me is up there as well. Probably in terms of enjoyment is the best one. I Brave New World, I found it to be the most mind-opening, but I thought that the character development in Brave New World was not very good. And 1984 kind of like passed me. I don't know. Probably it's because I read also Animal Farm in the same month, I think, a long, long time ago. And I love Animal Farm. So probably that's the reason why 1984 kind of like didn't leave any impact on me, because of the comparison. No idea. But with this one was the same thing. I kind of was eager to read it the first time because I was... I knew what it was, and like the Russian obscure dystopia that influenced Orwell. Oh, I gotta read that. So I was pretty supposed to like it. And the first time I liked it, but from the beginning I already got the feeling that everything is a little bit too much in your face. The world, of course it has to be, because if it's the first dystopia, it's something new for the readers of that time. So I guess that everything has to be laid out. But to me as a reader, it just meant that although it is a very enjoyable read, it's not a book that I would reread. That's why this is the last time that I'm sort of picking this book, probably. Although it gets very poetic at times. Yevgeny allows himself to dream, and like there's many moments that feel like he's wanting to, I don't know, cover it all, talk about the universe and nature and everything all at once. And I always like that. I like that kind of approach to, you know, you're talking about a certain feeling that you had when you were doing something, but instead of just saying that you had that feeling, you say that like your body was filled with electricity and suddenly you felt like you wanted to pour yourself into this person or whatever. That's another thing, which is also a theme in dystopias that I found, I've sort of like realized that there's always sort of like a parallel relationship that's happening that sort of serves as a reflection with one character and the other one. It's kind of like showing two different perspectives, and also how the relation between these two characters creates a big part of the dramatic action in the in the book. In this case, the main character, which the name, it's no names, it's all numbers, that's right. Everyone in this book is it has a number instead of a name. So mathematics is kind of like the structure, like instrumental rationality is the god in this theocracy, because in some ways it does feel like a rationalistic theocracy. If you believe that sort of like reason cannot be held as a myth and that it cannot be followed dogmatically in the same way that a religion is followed, maybe you should check my read along on the Dialectic of Enlightenment. in that sense, that's one of the reasons why this book felt so familiar, coming from having read the Dialectic of Enlightenment again. Because that almost religious approach to rationality that makes every single character to a hooligan of mathematics and lack of feelings, in many ways it resembles, it reminded me of Wataka, which is a really nice science fiction movie, but even more reminded me of Equilibrium, which is a really nice sci-fi movie that not many people has heard of. If you haven't watched it, you should, because it's really, really, really good. And it hasn't aged very bad, unlike other sci-fi movies, because this one is also pretty old. I don't remember the age, but I remember that it was old. So yeah, there you go. So, you know, no feelings, rationality. We all sort of like this kind of like a swarm mentality where like I am just a piece of a whole. And this character kind of like self-diagnoses himself of having developed a soul. Well, someone says, diagnoses him of having developed a soul, but he realizes that that something is wrong, and he wants to go and talk to someone. But also, he has this. I'm sorry, I don't write scripts, which means that everything is kind of free association when I make a comment or a recommendation about a book. I don't have a clear structure, but that's how it is. That's who I am. Deal with it. There's another theme here which I found kind of funny is that, like, you know, of course there's no privacy. Your window should always be sort of like without curtains, except when you are having sexual relations. And in order to have sexual relations, you need to do a bureaucratic application throughout the state or the city council or whatever, and you kind of like can't have many. You should not kind of like be only with one person, because that is sort of like a selfish act, and everything is sort of like everything really is towards the state. If you take drugs or don't take care of your body, it's not your body, it's the state's body. It's a part of a bigger, greater whole, so you will be executed. And in that sense, he has two partners, one that sort of like is in love with him and that wants to have a, wants him to make her a baby, but also knows that the state will take that baby, just like in Brave New World, you know. No individuals, no family, kids are not property of the families, but of the state, which is an interesting idea that is not as terrible as it might sound, in my opinion, because sometimes I feel like the randomness of the nuclear family can give you just as bad an experience as maybe state houses. No idea about that, but I just found I've always thought a lot about that idea specifically and how it would be. I definitely think that at least to become a parent you should sort of like pass some kind of exam, but that's just my own crazy whatever. They're not convictions, because it's more like a thought than anything. But yeah, what else? Yeah, and he is also is with this other woman that breaks all the rules. Like, she flirts and fucks with whoever she wants. She drinks and smokes, and he wants to report her, but he has only like 40 hours, I think, to report any conduct of this kind, and that is not enough the point is that he takes too long, so he cannot go to report it anymore, because after 40 hours what happens is that you are considered an accomplice and you're also executed. So and then sub that this woman is sort of like part of a greater revolution that wants to expand, and I think I've told you enough. I mean, I sort of said a spoiler. I don't believe in spoilers, I'm sorry. Whenever you see me starting to carry on about a novel, maybe if you don't want spoilers, just leave, because it's really hard for me to understand, especially when it comes to books. When it comes to movies, or to maybe to certain books that are based on a plot twist, I account for that. But if it's a book that is worth reading and that is not based on a single plot twist, you know, a book I don't like, which you will be shocked to hear this, but a book that I didn't like when I read it is The Great Gatsby. And that is a book that, for me, on my impression that time when I read it, it was based too much on a plot twist that it didn't even feel that shocking. But if I were to talk to you about The Great Gatsby, I would not tell you the plot twist. In this case, it's pretty predictable, and I don't think anyone would arrive into this without having read the other two, at least. I think it's pretty cool. I'll read you a couple of passages just so that you know. One about the sort of like swarm mentality, and then just saw the random one from whatever I have underlined. Yeah, here he says, this evening the distant Earth sent a reminder. In order to comply with the doctor's orders, I truly, sincerely want to get better. It's in between parentheses. I wander the glassy, linear deserts of the avenues for an entire 2 hours. Everyone else was in the auditoriums in accordance with the table, and I was alone. Really, an unnatural sight. Imagine a human finger cut off from the hole, the hand, just a single finger, hunched over, running around, bound over the glass pavement. That finger is me. And what is stranger and even more unnatural, this finger has absolutely no interest in reuniting with the hand, with the others. It either wants to remain on its own, or, well, I don't have anything left to hide or to be with her. I don't have anything left to hide or to be with her. That woman once again pouring all of me into her through my shoulder, through our intertwined fingers. And there you see as well sort of like how love is kind of in tension with the rationality of this state. And that's because sort of like the argument against rationality, both in philosophy through Adorno and here in this book, is kind of cheesy, you know. At the end of the day, what it's saying is that, you know, not all the forms of cognizing experience in the world need to be through reason. And two things that are not related to reason, one addressed in this book and one addressed in Adorno's book, which I'm also referring to, is love and magic, mysticism, respectively. However, the reason why I think that feelings is a better objection to reason is because to believe that reason cannot be mystic is not reason, but the cult of reason. There can be such a thing as a cult for reason. Scientificism is the word for it when it comes to that sort of approach to the scientific method. Not everything can be known through a scientific method, not everything can be experienced through rational thinking. And knowing that can give you a much greater epistemological humility, and of course allows you to experience things that, you know, people here who are numbers are not allowed to experience. So yeah, I mean, maybe I got a little bit too philosophical, maybe I should have gone more in depth into the book, but I think I'm just gonna leave it there. I'll just read you to end, to conclude, some passage that shows you a little bit more about the, yeah, this is fine, about the sort of like grandiose, more poetic moments where the character has like an introspective reflection. Everything is geometric here, the way they think and everything. But yeah, the quadrangle, freckles and matte blue veins turned a corner, disappearing forever. We walked as a single million-headed body, each of us clinging to the humble joy that probably also sustains molecules, atoms, fascicles. In the ancient world, the Christians understood this, our only, though very imperfect, predecessors. They knew that humility is a virtue and pride a sin, that we comes from God and I from the devil. There I was, walking in step with everyone else, but still separate. I was still shaking from that ordeal, like a bridge that's just been thundered over by an ancient iron train. I could feel myself, but feeling oneself, being conscious of one's individuality, is for an eye with something within it, an obsessed finger, an aching tooth. When an eye, a finger or tooth is healthy, it's like it's not even there. Isn't it clear that self-awareness nothing but a symptom of disease? I might not be a phagocyte anymore, calmly and industriously devouring microbes with blue temples and freckles. I am most likely a microbe now, and probably there are thousands among us already still pretending they are phagocytes like me. And on that note, I do recommend reading We. I do think that is a good book, and very enjoyable, and very, very fast to read. This much thinner than this. This feels like it was long, but as this took me one commute from London to Dumfries, which is like 4 hours, something like that. Not even that, because I also did some drawing. So there you go. We. From Yevgeny Zamyatin. Have a nice evening. I'll see you on the other side.